Good evening.
Good evening.
Woo! How spectacular is it to see you all here? Fantastic. Thank you for braving the cold and the snow to be here with us tonight for the first episode of Biotech 201 for 2016. And also welcome to the hundreds of you that are actually watching from home, or the hundred or so of you that are watching from home, where it's nice and warm. We're glad to have you here as well. We have a lot of ground to cover. Let me start by saying you are the fortunate, because you are the ones that in the first 10 minutes of registration for 201 got in. And then it filled up after 10 minutes. So congratulations, pat yourselves on the back. I've just angered all the people that are watching it online that weren't able to get in the first 10 minutes. So let's get started. Biotech 201 is sponsored by the Jackson Center and by the Hudson Alpha Alumni Association, which are members of folks that have graduated from Biotech 101 that support the educational efforts of Hudson Alpha and make Biotech 201 available at no cost and provide cookies and handouts and all those things. So my special thanks to those folks. We have a lot of ground to cover. And I want to make sure that if at all possible, I leave time for questions as well. Let me start by saying that each night, we'll have Hudson Alpha genetic counselors that will be available at the end of the evening. I'm going to ask them to come up here at the front at the end. They'll have on Hudson Alpha blue shirts on. If there are specific questions that you'd like to ask, now let me be careful here. This is not a formal genetic counseling session. This is not something that is you and the counselor that will show up, that will go back to your provider. They're here to provide educational guidance and maybe give you some direction, but this is not a formal counseling session. But having said that, if you've got questions and you'd like information, they're available. And right now, they're in the back. So Megan Cochran and Whitley Kelly are in the back, and they'll be up here at the end if you've got specific questions. And we'll have at least one every week during the four sessions for 201. All right, some key things that I want to remind you of. These are not in your handouts, because I just want to cover these briefly. I am a human geneticist educator. I am not a cancer biologist. So what I'm going to talk about is not delving deep into all of the intricacies and the details. On the wall behind me is a graph showing the number of scientific and medical papers that mention cancer that have been published since the 40s. And you can see that for 2015, there were almost 160 science articles about cancer. We are not going to cover 160,000 science articles. In January of this year alone, there were 15,000. So we are going to hit this in a very broad overview. I want to give you enough detail that you gain an appreciation of what's going on with cancer. But the reality is that our time is going to be more like this. So hopefully you can still tell that that looks like Einstein, at least a little bit, because we're going to be spending a lot of time in this level of simplification. So that's important. So I just want you to gain that sense that that's where we're going to be coming from, that I'm not going to be able to give you all the intricacies and all of the nuances, but I'll try to point you in those directions if you would like that information. Next piece. Cancer affects a staggering number of individuals across America and around the world. This is from the American Cancer Society cancer statistics page. In 2016, they estimate that there'll be 1.685 million new cases of cancer in the United States and 595,000 cancer deaths in the United States. So if you were to average that out, that's 4,600 new cases a day. If you dig more deeply into that in Alabama, 27,000 new cases in 2016. And then if you take that even more broadly, maybe you can't see this, but you'll note that in 2013 there were 8 million deaths to cancer worldwide. By 2030, there will be close to 14 million deaths worldwide. So this is a huge issue. It is one of the leading causes of death around the world. The estimates are that in the United States alone, every year, the costs to treat cancer are somewhere in the neighborhood of $88 billion in direct costs. That's hospital costs, doctor's visits, and medication. That's not any of the indirect costs like caregivers and lost time and lost productivity. Given that, I recognize that many of you in this room are very closely linked to cancer. Someone that you care about, a neighbor, a friend, maybe even yourself. So I want to acknowledge the incredibly personal impact that cancer has on us, even as we're in an audience of several hundred talking about it. So at times when I'm talking about cancer, it may feel like I'm talking about it in a very impersonal way, in a very just lots of individuals and lots of numbers. I recognize the tension of hearing about it from an impersonal clinical point of view when you or someone you care about is deeply engaged in that battle. And I just want to acknowledge that at times it may feel very, very personal, and at times it may feel very impersonal. And I recognize that that's a challenge that it's my job to try to grapple with. These are images from World War I. So these are American soldiers that are stationed at the French, at the trenches in no man's land in France, ready for battle. And I've got this image up here because well before Richard Nixon as president announced in 1971 the war on cancer, we've been using the analogy of war to describe cancer. Fighting the good fight. The battle is engaged. The troops are on the march. We're going to talk on our fourth session a little bit more about the language of warfare that we use, some of the challenges around that language, some of the places where it's actually really appropriate, especially as we consider how we deal with cancer long term. So I just want to put that up there, that you'll hear battle and war and those kinds of languages come out, and I want us to be aware of maybe some of the implications behind that. This is probably the most important image that I'm going to put up here. This is from a Greek, well, let me back up, the most important image from the first part. This is a Greek vase, and this is showing one of the Greek heroes, and I apologize, I can't remember if it's Achilles or if it's Hercules, I apologize, but he is battling the Hydra, which is a many-headed serpent. And every time he cuts off the head, one of the heads of the Hydra, two more grow back in its place. And it's not until he figures out that he needs to actually take a torch and sear and seal the stump when he cuts off the head for others not to grow back. And that's how he ultimately defeats the Hydra. That's an important image because we tend to think of cancer as one thing, a set of cells that are growing out of control, and if we can figure out how to stop that cell growth, then we've got cancer licked. When in reality, cancer is, I'm checking my phone to see if my team was telling me if it was Hercules or Achilles. No, they're not. That might be a clue to those of you in the back room that I might need that information. But anyway, cancer is a multi-headed beast. And that's what we're going to focus on, that there are multiple pathways that lead us to cancer. And no cancer is only caused by one, it's caused by multiples. And that becomes important when we start thinking about how we treat cancer. Because if we only focus on one aspect, one head, one face of cancer, there are a whole bunch of other doorways that we leave open for the cancer to reoccur or come back even stronger. So I want you to remember this image throughout our four sessions together.
It's Hercules.
It's Hercules, thank you very much. Hercules. Okay, cancer. We tend to think of cancer as dividing cells. Well, cancer is actually much more than dividing cells, because ever since we were a fertilized egg, we've been dividing cells as well. That's how we get to who we are. Every time your cells make the decision if they're going to divide or not, they go through division. Some of our cells, like the cells that line our digestive tract, the cells of our skin, go through this division quite frequently. Other cells don't divide quite so rapidly. So when we start thinking about cancer, I think we have to go beyond that cancer is simply dividing cells. Okay, so let's take that one step further. Cancer is rapidly dividing cells. Does that definition do it for us, that it's just cells that seem to divide rapidly? Well, not necessarily, because some cells in your body divide rapidly anyway, and some cells in your body divide slowly. So let's work through some key definitions to get us started. All right, these are words that you may or may not have heard, and I'm going to try really hard to use these words appropriately throughout our time together. Neoplasm. A neoplasm is an abnormal growth of cells that usually grows faster than the surrounding cells and will continue to grow if not treated. So a neoplasm is a rapidly growing mass of cells. Now you can divide a neoplasm into two different categories, which are here on the screen. Benign neoplasm is not cancer. It's a non-cancerous neoplasm. It tends to grow slowly. It's often localized. It doesn't spread. On its own, a benign neoplasm is not a problem unless it happens to occur in a place where its continued growth becomes problematic. It pinches on a nerve. It pushes the heart. It's in the brain and it's pushing brain cells because there's only a certain amount of space. So by themselves, benign neoplasms are not cancer. That doesn't mean they're not problematic based on their location, but they're not cancer. Malignant neoplasms are cancer. So a malignant neoplasm is when the cells invade the neighboring tissue or escape through the blood or the lymphatic system in order to spread. So when the cells have acquired the ability or are close to acquiring the ability to invade, to metastasize, there's our definition of cancer. Now, let me put these definitions, let me put some other words up here as well. Tumor. Tumor is a common nonspecific term that we and scientists and clinicians throw around. A tumor could be simply a swelling. It could be a fluid-filled mass. It doesn't have to necessarily be a mass of cells. It could be benign. It could be malignant. We talk about tumor and make some assumptions. We interchange tumor and cancer, but I just want you to be aware that tumor is a nonspecific general term. Cancer is another word for a malignant neoplasm. And then precancer cells are cells that are abnormal. They are on the way to acquiring all the necessary mutations to become cancer. And sometimes with precancerous cells, we watch and wait, and sometimes we go in ahead and we figure out how to remove or how to attack them so that they don't fully become cancer. So there's some background language for us to work with to give us all some consistency to start from. Cancer is named a couple of different ways. Cancer can be named based on the type of cell. So is it an epithelial cell, like the cells that line, that form our skin or line our digestive system? Is it a sarcoma because it came from bone? Is it leukemia because the cancer cells are our blood-forming cells? So we can name cancer based on the type of cell. We can also name cancer based on the origin. So it's breast cancer, it's lung cancer, it's colon cancer. And we can talk about a colorectal carcinoma. So then I've covered both. I've told you what cell type. It's a carcinoma. It's from the epithelial cells. And I've told you where it is. It's in the colon. So different ways that we name and define cancers. If you've been through Biotech 101, and everybody in this room has, there are some key pieces you've heard us talk about with cancer through that course. That cancer is a stepwise progression from normal cells to abnormal cells, precancerous, and cancer. It is not a straight from one to the other. There are multiple steps involved. The number of steps depends on the type of cancer, but what drives us from normal to cancerous is the acquisition, the stepwise acquisition of mutations in the genes inside those cells. So cancer is at its heart a genetic disease. Only a small fraction of cancers are inherited. We'll deal with that next week. The vast majority of cancers are acquired. So as your cells grow and divide, they will acquire mutations. They obtain a first mutation. And then over time, as they're dividing, a second mutation occurs in one of those daughter cells, and then a third. And each mutation moves us closer and closer to cancer, moving us out of normal cell growth, normal regulation of the immune system. The ability to recruit blood vessels becomes new. The ability to metastasize. Each of those stepwise mutations moves us from normal to cancer. And the number of mutations that are necessary varies, somewhere between maybe 3 and 12, varies from cancer to cancer. But these are in key genes. They're called driver genes. Mutations in driver genes is what moves us from a typical cell to a cancerous cell. So that's what we've covered in 101. I'm going to take us much deeper than that in our 4 sessions together. You've also heard me talk a lot about genomic technologies that have revolutionized the way we study human health. So this is the Illumina X10 high throughput sequencing machine. We actually now sequence DNA on these tiny glass slides, and we do this relatively inexpensively and incredibly rapidly, which means it's now realistic to take 200 people with a certain kind of cancer and sequence their tumor and sequence the benign normal cells next to it and look to see which mutations have now been acquired in the tumor. So much of the work that you're going to hear us talk about over the next 4 sessions is based on this kind of technology. Let me give you one example. This is called the Cancer Genome Atlas, TCGA. Hudson Alpha was part of the pilot in the early setting up of TCGA. And essentially, it takes these incredible technologies, and they say, we're going to study 12 different cancers. And each of these 12 cancers, we're going to recruit dozens or hundreds of cases of that type of cancer. We're going to get as much clinical information as we can about the patients that had those cancers. When did the cancer develop? What kind of therapy did they have? Was that therapy effective? And then we're going to look at the cancer in every way we can. We're going to look at it genetically, and we're going to see where there are DNA mutations. We're going to see what genes have been activated, what genes have been silenced. We're going to look at the proteins inside those tumor cells. And then we're going to take all 100 of those cancer cases, and we're going to compare them across the cancers. What are some commonalities that I see across all types of colorectal cancer? What are some differences? Can I tie those differences to how well patients responded to certain drugs or how aggressive those cancers were? Then I'm going to compare colorectal against kidney, against breast, against ovarian, against all these cancers, and I'm going to look for common themes across cancers, and I'm going to look for unique pieces within cancers. So that's the power of TCGA. It is completely fair to say that it has totally changed the way we understand cancer, being able to look at that from all those different perspectives. I'm going to show you an image that's not in your handouts, and it's an incredibly busy image, and I fully appreciate that those of you in the back of the room, that this is almost impossible to decipher anything from. I promise we're not going to dig deep into this. Here are the keys that I want you to take away. Let me move over to the side. Okay. In color here are the different types of cancer. So, bladder, breast, colorectal, and I can't read what the rest of those are, but so all the different kinds of cancer. Every column is a person with that type of cancer. Every row is looking at a specific spot in our genome and saying, is there a mutation in that spot or not? So looking at thousands and thousands of spots across our genome, across hundreds and hundreds of patients. Let's look at this. Every single one of these green dots is a single letter mutation in the genome in those patients. So every single green dot is a mutation. And you can see right off the bat, this is a group of patients with breast cancer. As a whole, they have very few green dots. compared to this subgroup of people with colorectal cancer that have an enormous number of mutations. And then if you squint, you'll see that this group of people right here that have a certain form of lung cancer all seem to have a common mutation in one common spot in the genome. And they also seem to have a common mutation because they've all got a green dot across all of the different columns in a different spot in the genome. So that seems to be some mutation that's very common to this form of lung cancer. So this is the power of looking at things like TCGA. TCGA came out with something in the neighborhood of like 120 genes that are commonly mutated across most forms of cancer. Whether we're talking about lung, liver, breast, colorectal, there's about 122 key genes that we really have to pay attention to that seem to be these major drivers of cancer. That's incredibly powerful information because it also says if I identify a treatment that I know will work because I'm targeting this genetic mutation in breast cancer, if I see the same genetic mutation in colon cancer or in lung cancer, it's quite possible that the therapy that works against that mutation in breast cancer will also work against that mutation in those other forms of cancer. So it really begins to open the door for how we understand cancer in a much broader sense. It's incredibly powerful work. All right, another important piece that brings us, that ties us back a little bit to Hercules and the Hydra as well. As cancer develops, cells acquire mutations, cells divide, more cells divide. Some of that group that's already got the first mutation acquires another mutation and it divides. Some of that group acquires another mutation. You can see the cancer cells beginning to change shape. So if you look at the entire tumor, if you take a step back, which we'll do in just a second in the video, you'll actually see that these cells have acquired many more mutations than these earlier cells. That whole concept is called heterogeneity. It essentially means that within a tumor, every cell in the tumor does not have the exact same set of mutations. I've got some subsets of the tumor that have one combination of genetic mutations and another subset of cells that may have slightly overlapping but somewhat different. This is important for a couple of reasons. Depending on where you take your biopsy, you may or may not be fully representing all of the types of mutations that are present in your tumor. It also means that if I take a biopsy from the tumor and I identify that it has a mutation in, let's say, the P53 gene, which we'll dig into next week, and I know that there's a drug that specifically will respond to cells with mutations in P53, and I'm going to give that drug, I can't assume that every tumor cell has that mutation. So I've got to be careful. This is part of the reason, not all, but part of the reason why sometimes the therapies don't totally destroy the tumor. They may destroy part of the tumor, they may destroy a large portion of the tumor, but I may have cells that either don't have that mutation or actually have acquired other mutations that makes them resistant to that therapy. And that's part of where the recurrence comes back. So we've got to take that into account, that most tumors have this level of heterogeneity where they aren't, every tumor cell doesn't have the same combination of mutations. All right, in 2000, there was a paper that was written that was published in a journal called Cell. And it was written by a scientist named Douglas Hanna and Robert Weinberg. And it said, we need to think about cancer in a slightly different way. Can we find some commonalities in cancer? Can we find some common themes that allow us to better understand how cancer forms in kind of a broader perspective? And they proposed 6 hallmarks of cancer, 6 unifying themes that are common to most cancers. It was the most cited paper in Cell for a decade. And then in 2011, the authors came back and wrote The Hallmarks of Cancer, The Next Generation. And that's the paper that we're going to use as our touch point for the next 4 sessions. If you type into your favorite search engine, Hallmarks of Cancer, The Next Generation, It will take you to the journal Cell. This paper is available as a free download. If you want to dig into it, by all means do so. I'm not going to give you the paper. We're not going to go in depth through it at this level, but it is a paper that is freely available. It's open access if you'd like to explore it in more detail. But essentially, the concept, the hallmarks of cancer, are underlying biological principles that are common to cancer that give us a specific way to think about the complexities of cancer. The original group said that there were six, the original 2000 paper. They added two more hallmarks and two more emerging characteristics that brings us to 10. That's what we're going to focus on. They've got these images for each one of them. So for our next four sessions, we're going to cover these. I'm not going to read through these. You can see them on the handout. Here's what we're going to do. So we're going to cover two tonight, three next Tuesday, three more next Thursday. That's going to be how we're going to make up the week that we missed from the weather last week, and then two final ones on the 23rd. So each night I'm going to cover some of these hallmarks. I'm going to talk about what they mean normally, what happens in cancer, and then I'm going to cover research that's going on here at Hudson Alpha that ties back to that, to give you a glimpse into what's actually happening here in the Institute, either with our researchers or with our associate companies or with some of our community initiatives. And then I'm also going to highlight something that you may be hearing about in the broader cancer story. So tonight we'll talk about liquid biopsies. 1 week we'll talk about immunotherapy, which is big news right now, to connect you to some of these larger pieces. So this right here is the format that we're going to work with. Now, you might have noticed that I have a really large Jenga tower over here. And we're going to refer back to this. And this Jenga tower actually has some of the Jenga blocks with the images of the hallmarks of cancer on them. I'll come back to that in more detail. But essentially, if you've ever played Jenga, you start out with a nice tower, relatively small, all the blocks are in a certain very precise order, and then you pull them out and you move them up and you build new shapes with them. And the goal is not to be the person that pulls one from the bottom when the tower collapses. All right, we're going to do a little bit of Jenga-ish the next four sessions. In this instance, cancer has grown out of control. We no longer have our nice original starting block. As we've mutated genes around each of these hallmarks, we've increased our cell number, the tower's gotten higher, but it's also a little more fragile. Cancer is very unorganized. It grows incredibly rapidly, it grows out of control, but it is not the nice, normal, organized cell division that you look at in normal tissues. The other thing that's important about this is as we dig into each one of these hallmarks, understanding the biology of what goes wrong that leads to cancer opens the door for how we design therapies that shut down this error, shut down this problem. So essentially, it's pulling out the weak link that knocks down the Jenga tower. But if you go back to the Hydra, the multi-headed Hydra, it is not enough to only treat one of these issues. We have to be able to look at it from multiple perspectives. So there's our Jenga tower. All right, so let's do our first one. Actually, let me stop. Let me take a look at our time. I got time for like two questions. Anybody out there that wants to raise a question?
They had an article tonight on CBS News about that liquid biopsy.
Yeah, there was an article on CBS News tonight about liquid biopsy. So this is really timely. So we'll dig.
$1 billion they're talking about. They said it would be spending $22 billion.
Yeah, $22 billion will be spent on liquid biopsy research, and the amount of money they anticipate will come back in if they're successful is many more times $22 billion. It's a big, big industry, and we'll dig into that. Yes?
The new cancer initiative
is the new cancer initiative, the new moonshot that was announced at the State of the Union address that's being headed by Joe Biden, will that affect us in any way? We certainly hope it will at Hudson Alpha. One of the goals is to provide more funding to the National Institutes of Health, specifically through the National Cancer Institute, and we have cancer-specific grants and projects through that. So ideally, more money, more collaboration will actually be beneficial and will allow Hudson Alpha to do more work along that same line. Does the presence of cancer affect the immune system? Yes, it does. And in our third session, two of the three hallmarks that we're going to talk about are specifically how cancer is driven in some cases by increased inflammation and this very interesting dance that cancer and the immune system engage in to try to stay at equilibrium until the cancer cells escape and evade immune system detection. So the immune system plays a huge role in cancer, and in the last probably 5 or 6 years, we've just really begun to dig into that, and that's why immunotherapies that try to restart the immune system to recognize the cancer have become such big business. One more.
Sounds like you're right on the edge of saving.
Yes.
The terminology going to change?
Yeah, so will the terminology change? So the question is that one of the companies that was here right before the institute actually got started, Applied Genomics, that the founder of that company talked about that at some point down the future, i.e. about now, we would be talking about a specific type of cancer that's found in the lung or a specific type of cancer that's found in the liver instead of lung cancer and liver cancer. I think we will begin to approach that. There always is a starting cell that the cancer originates in, and we're pretty closely tied to this is lung cancer or liver cancer. I think where we'll go with that, Bob, is we'll say this is lung cancer, but this is lung cancer with the following mutation profile. And so that's very different from this lung cancer with a different mutation profile. It begins to move us towards the concept of precision medicine, where I'm able to look specifically for changes in your tumor that allow me to better understand how your cancer will develop and what the prognosis and the way that I should potentially treat it. Good question. All right. So let's talk about our first hallmark. Sustained proliferative signaling. Lots of big words. In a nutshell, sustained proliferative signaling means that cells replicate in the absence of normal growth signals. Cells are dividing when they shouldn't be because there's no signal that says it's time to divide. And this is important because the ability to continually divide and form new cells is at the foundation of what makes cancer cancer. So this is one of the most Now, I'm not going to say most critical, but this is a key hallmark that is the, and this is the reason why we're going to start with this first. So we need to understand something called the cell cycle, which essentially says that every time a cell finishes cell division, it then grows for a while and then has to make a decision based on information if it is now going to commit to copy its DNA and then go through a process called mitosis to divide itself. So this is the cell cycle, this process of cell division, growth, copying DNA, getting ready to divide, and dividing. And that cell cycle has a set of phases. We're not going to dig into them, G1S, G2, and M. And the cell movement through the cell cycle is driven by a couple of things. Signals from outside the cell that say, hey, time is good, conditions are good, it's time to grow, or it's not so good. And signals inside the cell that say, do we have all our stuff in order? Are we ready to divide, or do we need to pause because we've got to fix some, we've got to repair some things? So this decision about going through the cell cycle is a combination of outside and inside information. Let me give you one example of what that looks like. Again, remember back to Einstein simplified. Key point to keep in mind. All right, so here's our cell. Here's the cell membrane, mostly fats. Here's the nucleus, and I've shown one chromosome, but here's all of our DNA. This interesting looking structure is called a receptor. It's a protein that crosses the cell membrane. Part of it's inside the cell, part of it's outside the cell, and it has a very different, a very unique shape on the outside. Think about the different kinds of gloves, how the glove, the baseball glove is slightly different than a softball glove, than a hockey glove, than a golf glove. But each of them grips or catches certain things. The same is true for your receptors. There are lots of different kinds of receptors on the outside of your cell, and each one of them is looking for a certain kind of molecule to bind. And many of these molecules are growth factors. They're things that are secreted by other cells that say, hey, the water is fine, come on in, let's divide. So here is a growth factor, and it binds a receptor, and it sends a signal inside the cell that says, hey, conditions are ripe, it's time to grow. Okay, let me give you an analogy. It is a gorgeous day in mid-April, and it's going to be 75 degrees, and you wake up in the morning, and you stick your head outside, and it feels warm. And you think to yourself, this might be a good day for a picnic. And so you're going to gather some more information. You've already gathered the fact that it feels nice outside at 7 o'clock in the morning. So now you're going to gather some more information. You're going to look at the weather. You're going to see if it's supposed to be rainy or cloudy. Is it going to be windy? Is the temperature going to drop throughout the day? And you decide, yep, I think I'm going to have a picnic. So then you've got to decide what you're going to cook. So you're going to open up your recipe book and figure out what things you need to make a flan or to make fruit salad or to make chocolate chip cookies. And so you're going to get all your ingredients, if you have all those ingredients, and then you're going to make all the things that you need, and then you're going to go outside and you're going to have your picnic. Everybody got that analogy with me? Okay, same thing happens in the cell. The cell is going to get information from outside. This is kind of like the equivalent of sticking your head outside to see what the temperature is. It's going to gather in other additional information, like the weather report. Do I have all the stuff I need? It's going to go to its kitchen, which is its nucleus, where its genome is, where its recipes are, and it's going to use the recipes that it needs to make the things it's got to have in order to divide. That's the equivalent of the picnic. So it's going to make all the stuff it needs, and then it's going to commit to go on the picnic. It's going to commit to going through cell division. So that image is what we're about to look at. So, ooh, it feels nice outside. Now I've got to get that information that it feels nice outside down to the kitchen to say we need to make the following recipes. So there's a whole set of molecules in between called signal cascade proteins, and they're messengers. They signal each other. One gets excited, one gets activated, a phosphate group is put on it. That activates it. It goes and finds its next partner, activates it. It finds its next partner, and it relays the, hey, conditions are fine signal from the cell membrane all the way into the nucleus. And once it's in the nucleus, then a transcription factor, which is another signal player, is activated. And that goes, and that actually activates the genes. That's the equivalent of getting the recipes ready and putting all the things, saying, okay, this is what we're going to need to make. So we make RNA, which is the copy of our genetic information. It meets a friendly ribosome. It creates a protein. And then that protein does its thing, which in this case, we don't have to worry too much about the specifics, but it essentially starts the cascade that says, okay, we're going to commit to the cell cycle. We are going to get ready to divide. We need to, and then you'll see over here, we need to move the cell cycle forward. We need to do all the things in place. We need to have all the things in place to make this happen. So I've started with outside information that says, hey, conditions are right. It binds to the cell receptor, which signals, transmits that signal across the membrane. There's a whole path of cascade proteins that activate a transcription factor that turns on a gene that is translated into protein that moves my cell cycle forward. So that's the concept. It's this relay of information that says, okay, it's time to divide. Now, that's cell signaling, cell transduction. Congratulations. That's your intro to cell transduction. We could spend like three or four college courses digging deep into that, but I don't think any of us really want to do that. Now let's talk about what happens in cancer around this. So here are the key players. There's no growth factor present. There's no, hey, the weather is fine. But if I have a mutation in a gene that makes one of these signal proteins, let's say that one, the yellow one, and the mutation now causes the signal protein to behave as if there is a, hey, the weather is fine, let's go, it now activates and carries out this entire signal. There was no growth factor. There was no external signal saying, hey, conditions are ripe, but the mutation triggered the movement through the cell cycle nonetheless. Everybody with me on that? Does that make sense? These are the mutations that cause our cells to go, to divide, to grow, even when there are no signals that say that they should be growing. So the cell now divides. Both of those daughter cells have the genetic mutation. They're making the protein that is incorrectly signaling as well. They're now growing and dividing. And so we're starting down that path. These are called oncogenes, these genes that, and the mutations in them that lead to cancer. So oncogenes are normally part of the growth signaling pathway, but when mutated, they cause the cell to behave as if there was a growth factor present. And they increase the frequency of cell cycling. You could have a mutation in any one of these parts of the cascade. So I could have a mutation here in the receptor, or in one of the signaling proteins, or the transcription factor, or the actual go growth proteins. Any one of these could be mutated, and this path will now move forward. And so, for example, in some pathways, so in the GRAS pathway, for example, I may have one individual with one form of cancer that has a mutation here. Another individual may have a mutation here, or a mutation here. The end result is the same, but the mutations occurred in different places. So if I think about a therapy that treats the mutation here, here, or here, that's great, but it doesn't do any good if my mutation is further downstream, because it's past the point of where my therapy would have intervened. So it's important to know where the mutation is. And I'm showing you one simplified growth pathway. There are dozens of growth pathways in the cells. So we have dozens of different places where the system can be mutated to lead us down this hallmark of cancer. I'm going to give you an example, the BRAF gene. So this gene is commonly mutated in malignant melanoma. And malignant melanoma is the sixth most common cancer in the United States. Over 60% of the mutations, over 60% of the melanomas have a mutation at the same spot in the same gene, the BRAF gene. The BRAF gene produces a protein that actually functions in this cascade, in this signal cascade, this relay system. And the mutation increases the activity of that relay protein 500-fold. So it is now signaling at the drop of a hat. It has a hair trigger to signal on. This is incredibly common. More than 60% of the of melanomas have this specific mutation. So it's a proliferative signaling mutation. It's an oncogene mutation. So now I know that. So now I actually, or someone else actually, here's the pathway. You can see why I told you I was giving you a simplified pathway. Here are different receptors on the outside that receive the hey, the weather is fine signal. Here's all the inside signaling, and here are the things that happen inside the nucleus where the genes are activated or silenced. There's the BRAF, where the BRAF functions. So in August of 2011, the FDA approved a small molecule. Here is the structure, the chemical structure of that small molecule that binds and inactivates the BRAF protein. So think about it, I've capped the protein so it cannot signal its next neighbor and continue that cascade. So I've silenced the cascade. The FDA approved this in 2011, and they approved it based on results that looked a lot like this. So this first image is a 38-year-old man with metastatic, so it is metastasized, metastatic melanoma. He has melanoma nodules throughout his body. This is before he starts treatment with this small molecule. This is 15 weeks after treatment with this small molecule. Dramatic, drastic changes. People thought that this was a wonder drug, and it is a targeted therapy. You knew what the mutation was. The drug was specifically designed to silence the effect of the mutation. Major changes. Now, there's a cautionary note here. Remember I told you that if I just pull out one piece of the Jenga tower, that doesn't necessarily mean I've knocked everything down. I've got other pathways. Starting at about week 17, 18 with these patients, the tumors came back, and they came back with a vengeance because some portion of the tumor cells found a way to evade or ignore the effect of this drug. They acquired additional mutations that bypassed the stop action, the block action of the drug. So a single drug is not enough when we think about these targeted kinds of therapies. But this is a dramatic example of what knowing the biology around the mutation can do when you start looking at therapy. And so there's a whole host of drugs over here on the right-hand side that are all targeted medications. They're all designed to specifically deal with a specific kind of mutation in a specific kind of cancer. So there are clinical trials for these. Many of these have already been approved. They are amazing. But again, what we've learned is that in most cases, this single drug is not enough. You have to give this in combination with chemotherapy, in combination with other types of medication to attack other hallmark mutations. But this is an example of a targeted therapy. Sometimes it's called a precision drug or a molecular targeted drug. These are big news. They're incredibly expensive. They cost a lot to develop. They cost a lot to use. But they are designed to target the specific mutation. So you have to start with a genetic test of the tumor to know if the tumor carries the right mutation. Because if the tumor doesn't carry the right mutation, this drug is not going to help you. So these drugs all start with a test of the cancer cells. All right, that's our first of our 10 hallmarks. Sustained proliferative signaling. I've got a question from online. The picture that I showed of TCGA with all of, where I talked about all the green dots, does that mean that it's not, for the cancers that have few green dots, does that mean it's not caused by a genetic mutation but something environmental? Good question. If you go back and remember the image I showed you of all the different kinds of cancer and I called attention to the fact that some of them had lots of green dots and some of them didn't, the ones that didn't have green dots just didn't have that specific type of mutation. They actually also had genetic mutations. Their mutations weren't a single letter change. They were more of large chunks of DNA being deleted or being copied or other ways that the genes were inactivated. So all of those cancers that I showed you from the TCGA project all have multiple mutations. They just have mutations that they've acquired in different ways. Really good question. Okay, inducing angiogenesis. This essentially means that we are recruiting blood vessels to come to the tumor. Tumors are unable to grow beyond about the 1 millimeter stage unless they can recruit blood vessels in, because the blood vessels bring nutrients into the cells and take away wastes from the cells. And normally, if you don't have any blood vessels, that has to happen by diffusion. And if your tumor is too big and has too many cells, the inside of the cells can't get nutrients in and get wastes out, and the tumor begins to die from the inside. So in order for tumors to survive and to grow, the successful ones have to recruit blood vessels. They have to recruit a blood supply to bring in those nutrients. And that recruiting of blood vessels, that development of blood vessels, is angiogenesis. So angiogenesis normally occurs in embryonic tissues, because you go from a single fertilized egg to an entire human, and you have to have blood vessel formation and development. It also, and then it gets shut off in adults. no new blood vessels except when you have a wound and you need to repair and form new blood vessels to heal the wound, or in the case of women as they move through menstruation in their monthly cycle, that as the lining of the uterus expands in preparation to receive potentially a fertilized egg, there are new blood vessels that grow in, and then that entire lining is shed when the woman menstruates. So angiogenesis is turned on and off in that window as well. But normally, other tissues don't recruit blood vessels. The process of recruiting blood vessels is driven by a little protein called VEGF, V-E-G-F, which is vascular blood vessel, endothelial, that's the type of cells that form blood vessels, growth factor. So this is a growth factor. It's one of those, hey, come on in, the water is fine, signaling molecules. But it says, instead of, hey, come on in, the water is fine, it says, hey, we'd really like some blood vessels over here. Could we start that process? And so it binds to cells that line existing blood vessels, and it triggers this really complicated cascade of activity inside the cell that ultimately leads to the sprouting and branching of brand new blood vessels in the direction of where all of the VEGF growth factor is coming from. So cancer cells secrete, here these little blue molecules, secrete all this VEGF, and the blood vessel that's nearby is activated and begins to sprout out, and the blood vessels begin to form in and around the tumor, and they supply the nutrients and take away the waste, and the tumor can grow. Now, tumor blood vessels are messy. They leak. They're convoluted. They are all twisted up in the tumor. They are not pretty, in part because we're not following normal blood vessel pathways. They've co-opted or hijacked the way the blood vessels are formed in order to get the nutrients that they need. So normally, understandably, VEGF, the hey, we need some blood vessels, that is really tightly regulated. You don't want any part of your tissue just suddenly turning on VEGF and having blood vessels everywhere. I mean, think about when you have blood vessels that form across the retina of the eye. Dr. Sellens, where are you? All right, that's called what? It's totally escaped me. Neovascularization. That's a bad thing. It's a really bad thing. It interferes with your vision. VEGF has been turned on and is in the retina cells and is recruiting blood vessels to spread. Same thing happens in cancer. They found a way to unlock the VEGF molecule, and the cancer cells are now pumping out VEGF in order to recruit those blood vessels in. So, can we use this in some sort of therapy? Turns out, likely, yes, we can. So there are molecules that inhibit the VEGF pathway. There's a couple of them. One of them is a molecule that is marketed as Avastin. It's a monoclonal antibody. So let me tell you what this is. So an antibody is a protein. It's a Y-shaped protein. And this Y-shaped protein is normally made by your immune cells, and each Y-shaped protein on its fingertips recognizes a specific substance, an antigen. That may be a foreign piece of bacteria, a foreign piece of a virus. It recognizes it, it binds it, and it normally signals the immune system that something is here that doesn't need to be here, and we need to mount an immune response. Modern medicine has taken advantage of that concept of being able to recognize and bind things, and it creates in the lab what are called monoclonal antibodies. They're made in the lab and they recognize a specific thing. This monoclonal antibody recognizes the VEGF growth factor, and it sticks and it binds it, and it binds lots of it. And if it binds VEGF, then VEGF can't bind the receptor in the blood vessels and start that sprouting process. So it essentially soaks all the VEGF up that the cancer cells are producing so that it can't bind and start the growth of blood vessels. There are other drugs that are not monoclonal antibodies, but they are other proteins that actually bind to the receptor where VEGF would normally bind and prevent VEGF from getting in. They got there first. So we never signal that we need to grow. So these are angiogenesis inhibitors, these molecules, and they again are specifically designed to target this one specific hallmark. They initially were looked at as being given independently, standalone, and they have some effectiveness, but they seem to be much more effective when given in combination with other with chemotherapy drugs. And in some cases, they actually shrink the tumor, but in other cases, the tumor doesn't shrink, but its size just stabilizes. So why that is still not fully understood. Now, you might imagine that before you give somebody a medication that's going to stop the formation of blood vessels, there might be some problems with that. There might be some potential side effects. And the initial studies suggested that maybe there weren't a whole lot of side effects. So a whole lot of clinical trials were started looking at giving these angiogenesis inhibitors in all these different kinds of cancer. Breast and colorectal and pancreatic and ovarian. And they are valuable. They do have a role in this arsenal of attacking cancer. But we've discovered that they actually have a significant number of potential side effects with them. Not surprisingly, they dramatically impair wound healing. So, and that makes sense. You know, I'm preventing the growth of blood vessels. And they also seem to affect tissues, organs that require a lot of blood supply, like the kidney and the heart. So exactly how effective these are going to be and how the right dosage is something that's still being worked out. But this looks like a powerful additional way to go over to our cancer Jenga tower right here and try to block this. So I've talked about sustained proliferative signaling. I've talked about angiogenesis. So that gives you a sense of two of our hallmarks of cancer that we're going to cover. Let me stop and see if you've got questions. Yes, sir.
We're at 10 factors now. Do you imagine we'll go to 15 or 25?
Oh, do I think we'll go to 15 or 25 hallmarks? I don't think so. We're at a place now, this is going to sound incredibly pride goes before a fall. So, but I think we're gaining a good handle on cancer. I wouldn't be surprised if some other, maybe a couple other hallmarks begin to be uncovered, but I don't think we're going to see a really, really large expansion. Others?
This is kind of an off-the-wall question, but under the heading that a lot of the treatments and things that you've talked about, there are multiple ways of doing things, and you can't just have one, you got to have different ways. Well, kind of along those lines, several references that if we want to go look it up and read about it. My question is about a reference like that.
Okay.
Within the last year, almost a year now, there was a 6-hour presentation, Ken Burns film, called Cancer, the Emperor of All Mountains. And I'm curious because there seems to be a lot of common thread here that you're talking about where there would be a dramatic breakthrough and then minutes later you would realize that dramatic breakthrough had terrible side effects and it came back with a vengeance. Is that a worthwhile reference to go check out,
so the question is it worthwhile to check out the Ken Burns feature on cancer, The Emperor of All Maladies? I've looked at not all of it, but I've looked at large chunks of it. It's really good. They do a nice job of putting it in everyday understandable language. Ken Burns is a fantastic filmmaker. It's gorgeous to look at. So I think that is, if you want to dig into that, that would be a great place to start. Any others? Yes, ma'am. So the question is, I've talked a little bit about how cancer is acquired, the mutations are acquired. Next week I'm going to dig into a little bit about the inherited risks. Can I talk about the environmental risks, the issues with do eat this, don't eat that, oh wait, no, I'm sorry, wait, you can't eat that, don't eat that over here, oh wait, no, wait a minute, you can eat that over here, and other things. I'm going to hit some of that in week three when we get into inflammation, because that seems to be the common core for many of these environmental factors. In the nutshell, though, the environmental risk factors seem to do one of two things. They either seem to directly mutate our DNA. So you think about like cigarette smoke. Cigarette smoke has chemicals in it that actually bind and mutate DNA. Ultraviolet light does the same sort of thing. And those mutations, if they occur in these hallmark kind of genes, that's problematic. The other issue is that many environmental factors, potentially certain kind of foods, obesity is another one, actually lead to chronic inflammation. And that chronic inflammation sends a whole bunch of signals that allow cancer cells to flourish. So we'll hit that in more detail in week three. Yes, ma'am. That is a great question. So I'm going to talk in week three about the role of the immune system. If you have an autoimmune disease and you take autoimmune medications, does that impact your risk of cancer? I don't know the answer to that, but I'm going to have my team who's listening write that down, and I'm going to try to get that so that I can incorporate that in week three. That's a really good question. All right, let me move us on. Being mindful of time. Oh, somehow I just ended my talk. Well, that's interesting. All right, so we're done now. All right, let's move on. There we go. Okay, now I'm going to move into the section about research at Hudson Alpha. This is a really, really cool story. It's a little heavy on the science, but hang with me. I think I've got some analogies that'll work through it. But it is a fascinating story. So hold all the way through and it will loop together. So here are the 15 faculty that make up, that are the 15 research faculty at Hudson Alpha, an amazing, incredible group of scientists that know genomics like nobody else on the planet. A subset of them heavily are focused on cancer, and that's this group. Dr. Rick Myers, Dr. Jin Han, Dr. Sarah Cooper, Dr. Sean Levy, Dr. Devin Absher, and Dr. Kim Strong, from left to right. And they and the senior scientists and technicians and graduate students and postdoctoral students in their labs are collaborating with groups like the University of Alabama, Birmingham, Stanford, St. Jude, Huntsville Hospital, working on specific types of cancer: breast, thyroid, kidney, pancreatic, ovarian, colon, and prostate. And they're looking at all different aspects of the genetics and how these genes are turned on and off and the types of mutations around these types of cancer. I'm going to tell you one of the many, many stories that I could talk to you about that comes out of the lab of Dr. Rick Myers, one of our postdocs, Dr. Brittany Lassane, and the team that she works with, working specifically in kidney cancer. Here's a from healthy to cancer to treatment to remission. Understanding genetics and looking for biomarkers or signals that give you insight into what's happening in the cancer becomes really important. At this stage, in terms of early diagnosis, once you identify the cancer, looking at the specific defects, the specific mutations that predict survival and treatment, that's what we just talked about with targeted therapies, and then actually following, monitoring the molecular signature of the tumor as the patient goes through therapy. So you're able to identify if there are those resistant sections of the cancer, those resistant clones that are able to escape therapy and that need an additional kind of therapy. How is the tumor responding? We're going to specifically talk about this early diagnosis piece with the kidney cancer. So there are 65,000 new cases of kidney cancer in the United States every year. It's one of the 10 most common cancers, and it is almost all acquired. So only 4%, less than 4% is hereditary, meaning someone inherits a mutation in a disease or a risk-increasing gene. So the vast majority of kidney cancers are acquired, multiple mutations over the course of an individual's lifetime. The challenge with kidney cancer is that it presents with very, very few symptoms. And the symptoms that it does present with are very non-specific. Abdominal pain. Not a whole lot of other kinds of symptoms. So it's very difficult to detect early on. But you can see I've got the four stages of kidney cancer behind me. If you can detect it at stage one, when it's less than 7 centimeters, less than the size of a tennis ball, the survival rate is 81% at 5 years. If you don't detect it until stage four, when many cases are finally caught, the survival rate's 8%. So there's a huge, huge need for a way to detect kidney cancer early. But you're not going to pick it up by a set of symptoms, so you've got to look for some other marker, some other signal that the body is sending out that there is cancer present. Treatment for the advanced cases is better, but even at its best, it simply prolongs the progression of the disease by a few months. It buys an individual a few more months of time, but not much more than that. And kidney cancer is unfortunately not very responsive to chemotherapy and radiation. So you really want to catch kidney cancer early, when it's small, when you can remove the tumor, when it's still encapsulated. So there's our background on kidney cancer. All right, now for our moment into science. Everybody take a deep breath with me. I can do this. We're going to cover a little bit of chemistry. Yeah, oh, now I said that word, didn't I? Chemistry. Okay, DNA is composed of four chemical building blocks: adenine, thymine, cytosine, and guanine. We abbreviate them A's, T's, C's, and G's. So you hear us talk all the time. You hear me talk about A's, T's, C's, and G's. Those are the four chemical building blocks. I'm going to talk about C, cytosine. Here's the chemical structure of it. I don't want you to worry about what that chemical structure looks like, except that I want you to see how it is different from a variant of cytosine called 5-methylcytosine. It's got an extra line right there. That extra line corresponds to one carbon and three hydrogens attached to the cytosine. You can think of it as a methyl cap. So the cap is attached to the cytosine. It doesn't change any other part of the structure, but if you're looking through your DNA and you see specific sequences of C's, often they're C's that are right next to G's, some of those C's may have a methyl cap put on them. So I just want you to think it's got a cap, it has a hat on it. That's what, when I'm talking about 5-methylcytosine or methylation, I'm just talking about putting a little hat of methyl on top of my cytosine. Now, that happens frequently, and sometimes 5-methylcytosine is actually called the fifth base: adenine, thymine, cytosine, guanine, 5-methylcytosine. Here's why that's important. The cytosines that are around a gene, especially on the front end of a gene, can be methylated. They can have the cap or not. This is a really broad generalization, but if they don't have the cap, then the DNA is generally in a much more unwound, flexible, loose shape. And if this is my gene here in yellow, it's easy for all the machinery that needs to come in to activate this gene to make this recipe in the kitchen, it's easy for that machinery to get in there because it's easy to access. It's open and loose. Now, if the cytosines are methylated, so the cap's put on it, it changes the way the DNA is coiled and packaged. So here are the yellow thumbtacks. Those of you in the back, it's kind of hard to see that, but I've got yellow thumbtacks on this same piece, and I've changed the shape. It's much harder for my machinery to get in here and activate this gene. It can't get in the kitchen. The door is closed. So So that's important because I did not change the sequence of the DNA. I didn't change the recipe. There are no mutations here. I've simply added chemicals to the pieces of this, to sections of this DNA, and I've now shut off this gene. So I have changed the way this gene is active or not simply by putting those methyl caps on my cytosines. Everybody with me on that?
Can you give a reasonable definition of methylation?
Can I give a reasonable definition of methylation? So Jim, I would say methylation is the addition of these, this carbon and three hydrogens, this methyl group, onto the DNA nucleotides. So I'm taking the chemical bases, the building blocks, and I am putting this chemical, I'm adding this methyl group to the building block itself. And so that's the process of methylation. And the methylation specifically happens not around the A's, the T's, or the G's, but around the C's. And when I do that, sometimes it changes the way the DNA is packaged, and that influences if I can actually activate and turn on this gene or not. Does that work? Sort of? Okay. Mark?
Is the methylation always bad, or is it sometimes bad, sometimes not?
Yeah, it's not all, that's a great question. Is the methylation always bad? No. In fact, there are parts of your genome, parts of your genes, that the normal state is being methylated and silenced. And taking the, and so having methyls is not in and of itself a bad thing. But the fact that whether you put methyls on or take methyls off can alternate if the gene is active or not, that's the key piece. That's what I want you to hang on to. So there is this process that puts methyls on and takes methyls off. So what is that process? Well, that's a little bit tricky. I'm not 100% certain that we know, so I can't really tell you. There's some really intriguing evidence that your diet might control a bit of this, and the way that you respond to stress, and your stresses when you were young and early on in development, so you can blame your mom for that. But exactly what controls this isn't fully understood. But the important thing is that it happens. And it seems to, let me catch up, it seems to be altered, these patterns seem to be different in certain types of cancer. So some cancer cells, the normal cell looks like this at a certain gene, and the cancer cell looks like this. Or the normal cell looks like this, and the cancer cell looks like this. And that shift may be important to which genes are turned on or silenced that drive the cancer. Is the bonding of the hat permanent? No, methylation is reversible. It can be put on and it can also be put off. There are enzymes that go around popping hats on and other enzymes that go around yanking hats off. The scientists in the room are cringing that I have used this analogy. So now you've got the hat analogy. So Dr. Lassane worked with researchers at Stanford looking at kidney cancer to say, can I identify a set of these cysteine residues that are consistently turned on or off between normal and kidney cancer tissue? That's the question. That's what she's trying to drive at. Can I identify specific regions that are characteristically turned on and off so that I could look at them and predict if this is cancer tissue or normal tissue? And that will become important. That's where we will loop back to. So that's the key. So she looked at 96 patients with kidney cancer, and most of them, the largest part of what I'm showing you, were clear cell carcinoma. She also looked at other types of kidney cancer as well. And she compared the methylation patterns between kidney tumors and the normal cells that were adjacent to the kidney tumors, the presumed normal cells. So I'm going to call them presumed benign, the normal cells. All right, don't flinch. Here's what I want you to notice. In the image behind me, yellow looks like this. Yellow means this, and blue means this. So every column If it's blue, let's get the pointer. If there's blue up here, that's normal tissue. If there's red up here, that's the tumor tissue. So every column is a tumor or a normal cell. Every row is a specific site in the genome where there is a C, and I'm looking to see if there's a hat or not. When you see blue, there are no hats. When you see yellow, there are lots of hats. When you see something in between, it means that some of the tumor cells had hats and some of the tumor cells from that same tumor didn't. Here's the key piece. Look here. The normal cells are primarily hatless. The tumor cells have hats. Look here. The tumor cells are primarily hatless. The normal cells have hats at those specific C's in the genome. So there are clear patterns. You don't have to dig into that any deeper other than to recognize that, yes, there are some specific sites in the genome where hat or hatless seems to correspond to tumor or normal. So Dr. Lassane then said, okay, that's 1,000 sites. Can I narrow this down? Can I pick the 20 best sites that predict tumor versus normal based on whether they have methyl hats or not? So she picked another set of samples. Very important. When you find something in one set of samples, you need to replicate it in a completely different set of tumor patients. So she picked a totally different set of data, 732. Here's the top 20. Again, you can tell, you can see a difference between no hats, hats. No hats, hats. So these 20 sites in the genome seem to be really good at predicting if that cell is kidney cancer or normal. In fact, here's the numbers. This testing for the presence of methyl hats at these 20 sites correctly identified 88% of the normal tissue and 96% of the tumor tissue. So essentially, you now have a way, by looking for the presence of these hats, to tell if a random cell that's given to you or a random set of tissues is kidney cancer or not. So a straightforward set of biomarkers looking for the presence of hats can distinguish with pretty good resolution if the cells are cancerous or if they're normal. That's exciting. That becomes a test that you can begin to use. Now here's the challenge. None of us really want to have our kidney poked at and prodded and biopsied to get to this. But as blood flows through your kidneys and as your kidneys collect urine, cells from your kidney are sloughed off into the urine and into your blood. Some of those cells remain intact as full cells. Some of those cells actually break open, so the DNA from those cells is in your blood or in your urine. So the question now becomes, can I get a blood or a urine sample from an individual and look for the presence of those specific hats? And if I find the presence of those hats or the absence of those hats, if I use those 20 markers as my guide, can I say this individual has the hallmark, has the signature, the molecular signature of kidney cancer from a urine sample or a blood sample? That is incredibly powerful. Early data from Dr. Lassane and some of her colleagues, Dr. Kirby and other folks in Dr. Meyer's lab, have said it looks like we might be able to get this information. So this is early days. We got a long time before you're actually going to see this show up in your doctor's office. But this concept, non-invasively identifying the presence of cancer long before you have any symptoms, that's a game changer for a cancer that is really poor at letting you know that it's present. That's a big, big deal. And that opens the door to this whole concept of liquid biopsies, which is essentially saying in the blood, in the spinal fluid, in the urine, I've got cells from all over my body. Most of the cells in my blood are red cells and white blood cells and platelets, But I've also got cells from other parts of my tissue floating through my blood, a small percentage of them. And some of those cells have burst, so I've got the DNA from those cells floating through my blood. So if I have a lung cancer, I've got lung cancer cells in my blood, and I've got DNA from those lung cancer cells in my blood as well. And if I can find the right set of tools, the right flags to identify them, I now have a non-invasive, very early detection system. That's a big, big deal. If we were in church, I would ask for an amen. I mean, that's a big deal. So there are lots of companies that have jumped into the liquid biopsy bandwagon. One of them is called Grail. And the reason that Grail is the first one that I'm going to talk about is because it actually has spun out of this small company called Illumina. Illumina is the dominant, it's not a small company, it is the dominant provider of all DNA sequencing machines around the world. So it is right now the company that does DNA sequencing. So they made big news recently when they said, we're going to actually form this company and we're going to devote all of the energy of this company to finding cancer biomarkers for liquid biopsy. And oh, by the way, Bill Gates is one of our major funders and we have $100 million to make us, to get us off the ground. This is a company to watch. That doesn't mean it's going to be easy. It's really, really challenging, and lots of efforts to try to do liquid biopsies have run into problems because, as you might imagine, it's a small number of cells in the blood that are the specific cancers you're looking for, and you have to go through what you just saw with Dr. Lassane's work to actually find the specific markers you need to look at and then figure out, can you get them in a liquid sample? There are lots of other groups that have stepped into this space as well, including, this company is an Alabama company. It's an Alabama company as well. I love this yellow is the new red. Yellow as in urine is the new red. An interesting marketing approach, but nonetheless, something to consider. Okay, so we've got some time for me to take some questions as we come to the end. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so is this what they do with, say, the PSA to try to find prostate cancer? Whatever, the 125 to find ovarian cancer?
So is this concept, liquid biopsies, biomarkers, what they do when they look at the PSA or the CA125 for the ovarian cancer? It's the same concept. It is something in your blood that you can easily measure. You're more familiar with the biomarker of your cholesterol. That's a biomarker, and that tells you something. The prostate-specific antigen and the CA125, the jury's still out on PSA and how well it works, but the concept being, if the PSA level goes up, it's indicative that you've got prostate cancer because you're producing more of the PSA. How that actually works is still challenging, and prostate cancer is a little more complicated because there are lots and lots of very slow, benign growths that would not become cancerous, but we don't know that yet because we don't have a good set of markers to be able to tell us, is this cancer or is this not? But yes, it is the same concept. Where are we in the practical use of liquid biopsies as far as the timeline? There are a number of groups that have started putting out liquid biopsies, and a few of them, I believe, have received FDA approval. I think that we are going to see them used much more frequently over the next 5 years, especially if we can validate that these are actually telling us what we think they're telling us. I think we are on the cusp of now developing technologies that we can start with an actual tumor sample, look for what's different, and then have very sensitive machinery and very sensitive approaches that let us detect it when it's much, much less frequent floating in a blood sample. Yes?
We all have two kidneys, obviously. You use a blood test or you use a urine test or whatever you do. How do they know where
That's a great question, Bill. So you got two kidneys, so if you take a urine test and it says, hey, you've got some high markers that indicate kidney cancer, how do they know where to go? They don't. So that then opens up the door for imaging. of the kidneys to try to see if you can find a mass and then move further. So this wouldn't tell you, hey, it's in your left lung or your right kidney or your left ovary or what bone it's in, if you found markers for bone cancer, but it would say you need to go for more specialized testing to look in this specific area or this specific type of area. Yes, ma'am. Norma, that's a good question. Are these going to become part of a regular physical exam? The companies would certainly like them to be. And I actually think once we've really validated and dug into them and found the right ones, I think they will be. In fact, there are a lot of people that suggest that this may not become part of a regular exam. This may become part of routine at-home monitoring, that you just routinely send, or you have a machine that sits in your bathroom counter that you slide in a sample and it analyzes it for a whole set of biomarkers and then flags you or flags your doctor when there's something that we need to pay attention to. We are clearly not there yet. But you know, I think it's not impossible to imagine what you see today for people with diabetes that are continually checking their sugar or have built-in meters, that we may in the future see something like that. Now, here's a challenge. There are going to be some level of false positives, and tumors form and are destroyed by your immune system all the time. So when we get to our third session and we talk about the immune system, the early stage, your immune system detects and eliminates lots of cancer cells. So if your immune system is already eliminating those cancer cells, are you going to be exposed to unnecessary additional testing, worry, concern, and analysis just because we have the ability to detect things so much earlier and at a smaller level? That's something we're going to have to navigate through and figure out. Yes, sir. Yeah, what is an acceptable level of false alarm? That's a very good question. Some of the answer to what's an acceptable level of false alarm is what is the follow-on analysis? If the follow-on analysis is a biopsy versus if the follow-on analysis is a scan or an additional blood test, you know, we may be willing to accept a higher level of false analysis if the next level is not invasive. Yes, sir, and then I'll come up to Bob. Ooh, the cell cycle timing. I don't know. I'll try to find that out. I know that in many cases it is not seconds. It is in many cases, now in bacteria, it's like minutes. But in human cells, I think it is much slower than that. But I'll try to get some details on the specific timing of the different cells across your body and how frequently they divide. Bob.
If you're doing surgery or chemotherapy, you need to know which kidney it
is. Yes. Yes, if you're doing surgery or chemotherapy or radiation that's targeted, you need to know what kidney it is. Yes.
I misspoke when I said chemotherapy. Chemotherapy goes and finds the cancer wherever it is.
Yes, unless it's directly injected in. But in general, if you take it as a pill or as an IV, it finds the cancer wherever it is. But you want to know so that you can get some senses of size, of potential spread, those kinds of pieces. So you're right. There are times when you really need to know where it is. I would say you almost always need to know where it is because you need to know if it's present in more than one location. Over here. Yes, sir, and then we'll jump right back.
The liquid biopsy.
Yes. How long does it take the FDA for tests, for approval of tests versus approval of drugs? It is less time because there's less, you don't have to go through multiple rounds. You still have to go through clinical trials to prove that it is detecting what you say it's detecting and it is not detecting something else. But that is a much shorter window I think we're somewhere on the order of a year, 18 months, 2 years, as opposed to multiple years of phase one, phase two, and phase three trials for drugs.
So this is less.
So that is faster to go through clinical trial because it is, in part because it's non-invasive, but the FDA still needs to know that what you say you're going to detect, you actually can detect.
Do most of us in this room have circulating cancer cells that our immune systems are killing off as we sit here?
Wow, do most of us in this room have, what a downer, have circulating cancer cells that our immune systems are killing off? At some point in your life, it is very, very likely that your immune system has killed off cancer cells at a very, very early stage in your body. The challenge, as we get to session three, is that your immune system and the cancer achieve this state of equilibrium where the cancer kills, the immune system kills some cells but doesn't kill others and keeps it in check. And then that equilibrium moves to escape where the cancer cells acquire signals that the immune system becomes blind to them, and then we're off to the races. So in the early stage, your immune system does a good job of catching it. So it's likely that, yes, thank your immune system because it has killed cancer cells in your body. Yes, sir? How does radiation therapy figure into all this? Radiation therapy, this will be my last question. Radiation therapy and chemotherapy damage cells. And they damage fast-growing cells. Chemotherapy actually, in some cases, binds the enzymes that would normally copy your DNA, and you have to copy your DNA to replicate your cells. Radiation damages your DNA, just like ultraviolet light, just like the sun's radiation damages your DNA. When you're given targeted radiation, you are subjecting those tumor cells to massive amounts of DNA damage. So much DNA damage that they activate a programmed death signal. Now, that was a perfect segue because next week we're actually going to talk about how some cancer cells escape those death signals and how they find ways to ignore when the body says, you've got to die. And that escape of death is part of what makes some cells resistant to chemo and radiation. Instead, they just get even more damage, but they don't trigger that programmed cell death. So here's what we're going to cover next week. Ignoring growth suppressors, so when the body says stop and the cell says no, escaping cell death, achieving immortality. Doesn't that sound interesting? Achieving immortality. We're going to talk about your telomeres next week. We're going to talk about information is power, which is this fantastic community initiative that Hudson Alpha and a company at the Institute called Kylos Genetics has put together to identify the presence of inherited mutations that increase your risk of breast and ovarian cancer. So it's an Information is Power initiative. I'm going to talk about it. We'll have our genetic counselors here as well. And then we're going to talk about hereditary cancer panels, so we'll tie into that. So that takes us up to time. I'll be up here for questions. Our genetic counselors will be up here for questions. Please drive home safely, and I will look forward to seeing you next Tuesday. Have a good night, everybody.